about?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have an opinion as to whether or not how that whether or not that ceramic is stuck to the chair by blood or how it would rot at that location?
There could be two or three options for that. It appears that there's a little ledge or a roll in the fabric that it could be actually sitting on. It's a charred piece of ceramic, so there could be a sharp edge that it's attached to, attaching itself to the material. So there could be a lot of different explanations for that.
So you wouldn't opine that there's no other explanation other than it's stuck in blood?
No.
Again, moving to slide 92. What are we looking at?
Slide 92 is the overall view of the chair with the backpack and the blood stains.
Sorry. Slide 93.
Slide 93 is a top view of the chair. And what you'll start to notice is that there are some transfer stains on the arms of the chair. There's also some spatter blood on the wall behind the chair. And then there's also a void area on the very top back portion of the chair.
When you say a void area, what do you mean? I know you described this earlier, but just to make it clear, what are you talking about when you say void area?
It's an area absent of blood. So you're going to see that there's blood on the wall above the chair back, but on the top portion where you see the tan area, it's absent of blood.
Slide 94.
Slide 94 is an overall view of the wall behind the chair, and you start to see some spattered blood on the window blinds.
Now, as we start to go through the photographs of the blood spatter, if there is something on forensic note, I want you to go ahead and point it out to the jury. Okay?
Yes.
Slide 95.
Slide 95 is a photograph depicting some charts of the broken lamp debris, also the pile of debris that, that appears to be books adjacent to the antenna.
Slide 96.
This is a more close-up of that pile of debris and books that appears that it may have fallen off of the entangle adjacent to the chair.
Slide 97. You need to get down.
Slide 97. It's a glass top table. That's why it's hard to see. But on top of the glass top table, you'll see areas of wind. And also, there's a couple of cast off stains that are very elliptical, and they are leading from the chair going from left to right, or direction of travel.
Now, what does that tell you? When you say cast off stains going left to right, what does that tell you?
That tells me they're coming from the area of the chair traveling across the table in that fashion. So, you can see where the arm of the chair is. So, those droplets are moving across the table, and a couple of them.
Slide 98.
Slide 98 is a photograph depicting the body wrapped in a green blanket on the floor.
Sorry, slide 99.
Slide 99 is a photograph depicting what appears to be a broken golf club in the trash can.
Slide 100.
Slide 100 is various golf clubs that are sitting in the corner, and there's one or two of them.
Slide 101.
Slide 101 would be a photograph depicting the general area of the golf clubs with the items that are on the table. And then in the background, you'll see a trash can on the kitchen floor.
Slide 102.
As the police are unwrapping the body of the victim, on some of the clothing, you'll see a broken arm to the eyeglass.
Slide 103.
It's just a general overview of the victim's body as it's being looked at and by the police.
Slide 104.
Slide 104 is a close-up of the top of the chair, and if you look at the louvers to the right-hand side, you'll see what appears to be an impact pattern. It is a clear pattern of impact. The stains are very circular in shape, and they are the size that you would expect from any type of law enforcement trauma.
Slide 106.
This is a more close-up view of that impact pattern. It actually extends in, onto the clinician lines behind the sofa back, or the chair back, excuse me.
Slide 107.
107 is a more close-up picture of that same impact area.
Now, before I move on, I'm going to ask you if you need to refer to your report, you can refer to your report. But did you make any note from a forensic analysis standpoint as to the blood spatter that you observed on the wall? It was specificity. Or excuse me, on the blood. I'm sorry.
Yes. The blood stain pattern on the lines is consistent with a combination of impact spatter and cast off. So the impact would be from the force of the injury, and then the cast off would be from the change in motion of speed, which is blood coming off of the injured weapon.
Now, can you tell from the impact spatter, can you tell whether or not the injury event, the impact event occurred while the individual was sitting on the chair or out of the chair or anything? Can you tell any of that by the blood stain, by the blood stain pattern?
Everything is consistent with the victim being in the chair during blood cutting.
And 108?
108 is a more close-up picture of the chair, the saturation stains, the backpack, and the debris that's on the chair seat itself.
109?
109 is a more close-up picture of the backpack.
110?
110 is after the backpack is removed from the seat of the chair, and you'll notice a void area on underneath that. So the void area is where when the backpack is removed, then you have a void on the seat, an area absent of blood. So in other words, the backpack is there during bloodshed.
111?
111, we have some transfer stains on the left arm of the chair. There's also a couple of areas of saturation, which is blood that's been deposited and absorbed into the bottom of the chair.
Now, let me ask you a question about the transfer stain on the center left side of the photograph, what I'll describe as the arm of the chair. Can you come to any conclusion with respect to the orientation of the stain on the chair? In other words, can you describe what would have caused the transfer stain on the chair?
Something bloody coming in contact with that arm. And it could be one of two scenarios. It could be the person that is doing the beating, having blood on their hands and coming in contact, or if you notice that the victim also had blood on the palms of both hands, so it could be turning from right to left or left to right. Because we do have transfer impressions that are consistent with hand impressions on both arms of the chair.
And in your review, did you see any DNA analysis done of the transfer stains that were on the chair?
No, they did not do that in the lab. But when they extract either touch DNA or actually DNA from the blood by doing a profiling DNA.
And I'm going to skip over 112 and go to 113. Can you describe what we're looking at here?
113 is looking as you're sitting in the chair. This is looking at the left arm. As you're standing, it's the right arm, the right side. But it's again another impression that's consistent with transfer.
114.
This is a more close-up area of that transfer impression on the arm of the chair.
115.
Even more close-up picture. This would be an examination quality photograph or analysis.
116.
116 is depicting blood stains on the glass end table adjacent to, as you're sitting in the chair, it's adjacent to the left
122?
122 is just another area on the boat that has transfer stands.
123?
123 is a photograph showing some cleanup liquid that was noted in the photograph.
24?
124 is a photograph going back to the kitchen area, back to the sink, and these are items that was found in the sink. There was a knife that was found in the sink, and then when it was flipped over, there was one on the opposite.
125?
That is the knife that was flipped over, and it's a good picture of the knife with the bloody side. And you'll notice the knife that there are two prongs.
126
is a photograph depicting the area of the golf clubs. This is just another view of the golf clubs we've already seen.
127.
This would be a photograph up close of the golf heads of the golf clubs. And you'll notice that there's two that are absent the head areas.
So there's two clubs in this area that you observed, or two clubs that don't have the heads attached to it?
That's correct.
Okay. 129.
129 is a photograph depicting a trash can that was in the kitchen area. Kitchen area.
130.
As the trash can is documented, you see that there's a beer bottle on top and a lampshade.
131.
131, as they were removing items and evidence from the trash can, broken ceramic lamp with a hole on one end that has a threaded attachment.
And 132?
132 is a photograph depicting the Blue Moon beer bottle that was in the trash can.
133?
133 is a close-up picture of the lampshade.
134?
134 is a more close-up picture of the lampshade and scale.
135.
135 is a photograph depicting broken portions of the lamp with blood staining and a portion of the shade from the top to the down.
136.
136 is an overview of the broken lamp.
137.
137 is a portion of the broken lamp. Appears that there's a cast off stain on the lamp, and this appears to be the bottom portion.
138
is on the back side of the broken lamp. It appears that there are cast off stains on the back side.
139.
This is a more close up photograph of the blood staining on the inside of the broken lamp.
Would you describe these as cast off?
I would describe these as cast off.
140.
140 is a more general view of that same interior of the broken lamp.
141.
141 is a photograph with scale depicting the same portion of the broken lamp with the cast off stain.
142.
142 is the upper portion of the lamp. And this is in the lamp, and there appears to be a rod that's going through the lamp.
Now, we're going to get to the rod a little bit later, but do you find any forensic significance in the rod as you observe it here?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
It's very circular, very round.
143.
143 is a more close up of all the transfer stains of blood on the broken portion.
Sorry, 144.
This is a top view of the broken portion of the lamp. Michael actually fits in.
145.
145 is a side view of the lamp showing the rod that's going through that is threaded at the very top, and then the bottom portion is flipped upside down, so that's
Now the next slide is label 146, is additional label processing and crime scene. I'm going to go through these as quickly as I can, but I want you to point out whatever you see that's significant in both of them, okay? 147.